everybody.
I suck at communication. That's the first thing that people tell me when I tell them that I work in the communications field. And I've done everything from PR to content to social media, kind of the whole thing. And that's the thing that people tell me, you know, that they're just not good at communicating with other people. And I find that kind of odd, because there isn't anything more important than communication. Being able to concisely express your ideas while empowering people who listen and inspiring them to act is one of the most valuable commodities that we have to sell as people, both personally and professionally. However, so many people just resign themselves to being like, hey, I'm just not very good at this, and that's the end of that. Well, how do we get people to change their minds about their communications skills? And what are the steps that they have to take in order to improve them? Okay, so before I go any further, I'm going to address the elephant in the room and tell you that I stutter. And stuttering is awesome, because you can't say the things that you want to say when, you know, everybody else can just talk and you're like, my name is sh-sh-sh-sh-sh, and it's very embarrassing. It's very hard to deal with. However, it has taught me a lot of lessons. But even all of the lessons I've learned, it doesn't take away from the fact that I have trouble, you know, saying my name. Let alone, you know, talking to people about something I'm passionate about or something that I'm just interested in. And it has affected pretty much every area of my life, both my personal life as well as my professional one. And even though it is awful at times, I feel like I've learned a lot of valuable lessons. So this talk is called How to Talk to Humans. And I think the basis of just talking to people is a conversation, right? And so we can all agree that a conversation is the exchange of ideas, right? So person A has an opinion about something and they want to tell person B, and then person B, you know, responds to it, and then they go back and forth until they come to a resolution, and then the conversation is over, right? And so how we approach conversations is probably about the same way every time. You know, we think of the words that we would like to use, right? And we think about how we would like to feel, how we want to sound, and how we want the other person to feel and react, and what we want them to say, right? It's all about us. Me, 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 I. And that is the exact wrong way to approach a conversation. You have to be thinking about the other person, you know? How do they feel? What do they want to say? The focus has to be on them, right? So, how do you make the focus on them? the first thing that you have to do is listen more than you talk. So this is me. I was around 3 years old. I know, I'm adorable, don't say it all at once. And this is around the age that my parents told me that I began to stutter. But it's actually pretty normal. A lot of kids who are around, you know, 3 years old, 4 years old, they develop some sort of speech impediment. Generally, it's stuttering. Occasionally, it's a little bit of a lisp. But after, you know, 2 or 3 years, it just goes away. And also, stuttering actually runs in my family, and pretty much everybody else is in a way between the ages of about 10 and 20. And so, you know, we didn't really think anything of it because it was, you know, obviously it was going to go away. Not quite, clearly. So as I got older, and as I went through life and I hit all of the major milestones, it became extremely clear that I was going to have to deal with this for as long as I wanted to stick around. And so, like a lot of other stutterers, I developed coping mechanisms in order to kind of deal with, aka avoid, stuttering. Something that I did was I used a lot of filler words like and ah and like and those things. I would also change words because if I was about to come to a word that I thought I was going to stutter on, I was like, no, I don't want to embarrass myself, so I would think of another word. I actually know a person who was very, you know, just higher level thinking, and so he read the dictionary, so he could always have another word on hand. He's very impressive, and clearly had a lot of time on his hands. He's also my boyfriend. So eventually, I came to a place of like, hey, if I just don't talk a whole lot, I'm probably not going to stutter because I'm not talking. This is a great idea, except it's an awful idea because it either came off as I was either, you know, uninteresting or I was not interested in the other person. And oftentimes it looked a lot like, hello, goodbye, please don't talk to me. And it came off like this. And so, you know, I had to figure out a way to be an active part of the conversations I was in, and not talk a whole lot. And so I began to ask people a lot of questions, right? I would just ask them things until we hit on a topic that they just, you know, loved talking about, right? And so I would do this time and time again, and a pattern develops. I realized that these people actually like enjoy talking to me, right? And I think it's because I was choosing to, you know, actively listen to them and be, you know, interested in the things that they have to say. So all of us here, I would say, like all of the millennials and Gen Y, I believe now there's a Gen Z, apparently. We all live in a sharing society, okay? As people, our brains are wired to connect, and we just have a need to be accepted, right? And so all of the Facebooks and Twitter and all of that stuff, it allows us to be able to share ourselves with other people with pretty minimal judgment, right? So as I was talking to people and, you know, hearing all of what they had to say, I was basically just taking the sharing society offline, and I was allowing them to feel like I was giving them, you know, a thumbs up on themselves, or, you know, a retweet or a like, if that's even relevant. But yeah, it was. So how does that look for you? It's asking a lot of questions and being actually interested in the answers. And this does two things. It shows the other person that you are both interested in them, and it also shows that you are empathetic towards them. And empathy is a pretty important key in communication. So, like a lot of other stutterers, I have had my fair share of therapy experiences. I was in speech therapy when I was around 8 or 9 years old, and then I took some time off. I went to high school, I went to college, you know, I got a job and all that stuff, and then I returned to therapy again in my late 20s. I was a freelancer, and so I had to go out there and find my own clients, and I was just having a very difficult time talking to people. I was terrified to even, you know, have coffee with people and CODA and the networking events, because I was afraid that I would sound, you know, bad, and that I would be judged. And so I sought out therapy as a way to kind of overcome stuttering. And so I found a therapist who was around my age. I think she was only 2 years older than me, and she was also a stutterer. And I went to her, and I was expecting to be able to just learn some techniques that would make it a lot easier for me to avoid stuttering. Again, clearly, that's not what happened. But what I did learn from her is how to be a lot more empathetic. I had been around other stutterers before, and every time I was so uncomfortable that I would just leave the room. And I couldn't do that here. I had to sit here and I had to listen to her talk. And in the beginning, it was pretty awful. But as time went on, it did get easier. And it also helped me to be a lot more empathetic towards her. And as a result, I was able to open up a lot more to her about the emotional side of stuttering and how it made me feel just on a day-to-day basis. I do not believe that there is enough empathy in everyday communication, and that's a shame, because empathy is the cornerstone of connecting with other people. Empathy creates the environment for other people to share meaningful details about themselves with you. And the therapy experience that I had is a perfect example of that. Empathy also helps you to be able to open up to the other person who you are talking to. So I began to speak about a year and a half ago, just to get myself out of my shell. I know that I've said this before, but I was truly just terrified to just talk to people. And so I'm the kind of person where, you know, if I'm scared of something, I'm just gonna do it. I don't know how to swim, so I'm gonna jump in the deep end with the sharks. Why not? What could go wrong? And so I was pretty nervous the first time I spoke, because I thought that the awful things I thought about myself, I thought that other people would think those things about me, and then I would have to face that. Well, it turns out that people didn't judge me. They didn't even shun me. They truly embraced me, and they wanted to share their stories of, you know, fear and vulnerability and weakness with me. And I think that's because I was willing to tell my whole story. You know, I would give these talks, and these talks are pretty exhausting for me. And so after the talk was over, I'm obviously like emotionally drained, because I'm showing all of these people like the very painful parts of myself. And again, I was ready to just run out of the room, because I'm done talking now, so leave me alone. But I couldn't do that. You know, people would come up to me after talks and tell me the ways that they were flawed, or the things that they were afraid to say or ashamed of, or the things that they hid from. You know, I showed my vulnerabilities, and as a result of that, they were empowered to show me theirs. And that's an important point. You know, a lot of people in this sharing society, they only talk about the good things. They only talk about, like, you know, I got a promotion, I got a raise, I'm starting a new business. They don't talk about how it's, you know, it's terrifying to do those things. They don't talk about how hard it is to be an entrepreneur and how incredibly lonely it is, right? People don't identify with perfect. They identify with being flawed, right? So your struggles and your insecurities, those are the things that make you incredibly interesting. And that's what people are going to take with them. And so, how do you talk to humans? The key is this. It's being empathetic. Being empathetic enough to listen to other people's stories, and courageous enough to share your own. Thank you.
I'm curious how, in a basically in a business environment, how you would translate some of these points that you're making. Because I can see a lot of what you're saying in an overall context. But if you're with your coworkers or something like that, maybe in meetings or with other clients, do you feel like these same things translate, or how would you shift it?
Right. Okay. So the thing I like to tell people about this is that other people are constantly telling you how to talk to them, right? And so the main thing that you want to do is just pay attention to the cues that other people are giving you, right? So an example that I have is this. The easiest thing to do is to check out like body language, right? And so and there are, you know, endless TED talks on this. The body language cues that that I kind of go by is, I really don't want to use this phrase, but anytime people are leaning in, and there, I know, right? I'm up here, it's never ending. Arms are a little bit more open and to the sides. They are just a lot more open and interested in the things that they have to say. I know that eye contact is another thing, even though it can be a little bit tricky. People can get a little bit nervous, and then they look away from you, and sometimes it can be taken as like, well, I'm not interested, or I don't want to talk to you, and actually it's just nerves. So those are those two things. In terms of just empathy, the easiest way is to just keep on asking people open-ended questions, right? You truly do just have to listen a lot more than you talk, and then kind of allow them to take the conversation to a place where they are just incredibly like open and comfortable and are having a pretty easy time just talking to you. So those are my tips.
Hi, thank you. You mentioned that the best way to show someone you're interested is by being genuinely interested.
Yes.
What if you want to be interested, but you actually aren't?
It depends on the situation. If you're in a personal situation, then like, hightail it out of there. But if you're in a more professional setting, then as hard as this is to believe and as hard as that is to practice, like every single person has something that is extremely fascinating about them, right? And it's just about allowing the other person to just get to a place of being comfortable enough to just keep talking to you. And if you allow them to talk enough about the things that they are interested in, then you can kind of control the conversation from there. It's a lot easier to get people to do the things that you want them to do when they feel like you are actually interested in them. And to be actually interested in them, you have to allow them to talk first. Okay.
seen on reality shows, like people, like in American Idol and other shows, the people who have stirred problems, they, if they sing or they speak like in the way of lyrics,
mm-hmm.
they can speak better. So does it work for you? Or?
I mean, I am like Beyonce when it comes to singing in the car. I've never started, ever. I'm in the wrong career. Too bad I can't say.
Can't you speak like, even in a normal talk, you can say like, just I'm singing some lyrics and you can go
yeah,
fast.
That's not quite how it works. but they do like teach you things, like how to speak in a way that makes you more sing-songy. The problem is that it kind of takes all the like inflection and personality out, and I would just much rather talk and see what happens.
Let's all give her a round of applause.